I'm Mark Pitchers, fishery owner, consultant and carp freak.
Double bubble.
Big pits, tiny ponds, day tickets, club lake syndicates, I've fished them all.
Let's turn up for the books.
I love the peace, the tranquility, the anticipation and the thrill of the chase. But ultimately, it boils down to one thing, a carp in the bottom of a landing net.
High five.
I've been the traveller in Crafty Carper. I'm now the face of Total Carp's 20s challenge, so I certainly know a thing or two about catching carp under pressure.
But I now face my toughest challenge yet.
Carp fishing missions set by you
on Fox's Facebook page.
And once the guys at Fox select that challenge, I have no option but to accept. Can I do it? Yeah.
Oh, we've got him. Yes.
This is the challenge. Gladiator hands. That's carpy. I'm gonna dub a bit of Enya music or something like that over the back. Was it Enya? The grasshopper on me, that isn't carpy.
What's up, carp freaks, and welcome to my third challenge. This is one I'm really looking forward to. Jake Waterman wrote in and asked me if I could catch a carp from a river such as the Neen. So, Jake, here we are at the River Neen. And I'm, like I say, this is something I'm really looking forward to. I've never ever caught a river carp. I've only ever done 24 hours on a river before, which ended in a blank. So I can catch my first ever river carp, especially on film. It's gonna be absolutely awesome. Can't wait to get started. The river's just behind me. I'm gonna go for a walk now and bait a few spots, so why don't you come along with me? Now, no matter what type of water you fish in, location is obviously key, but even more so on a river. And you've got miles and miles of water, and there may be stretches where there are no carp at all. So obviously we need to try and find any sort of clues to try and locate the carp. I mean, I'm stood on a bridge, prime example. Any sort of structure is going to act as a fish holding area, hopefully. And then we've got weir pools, moored boats, lots of overhanging trees, lily pads. My own personal favourite, back channels. So I think what I'm going to do now, I've got my walking shoes on, I'm going to go for a walk and see what I can see. I've just been flicking in a few pellets, feeding the chub just for a bit of fun. And out of the reeds pops a carp about 20 pounds. Can't believe it really, so we're gonna get a bit more bait in here. And this is obviously looking like a good spot for mummies later on today. I don't think it's carp, it can't be, it can't be.
It can be.
It can be though, can't it? That's the thing. I don't think bream would kick it up like that, would they? Oh, sorry. Well, just about half an hour ago, I baited up that area where I saw that carp, and it's already coloured up big time. I don't know if it's carp that are feeding there, or bream, or what, but something's feeding. It's just a big muddy cloud all over where I put the pellet. So I think what I'm going to do, like I said, I don't even know if it's carp that are feeding, but I can't ignore it. I'm going to run back to the van, get a rod, And I think it's certainly worth a few hours here. Shake. Come on, you f***ing idiot. Oh, I'm getting in a mood now. Hot thorn. Well, that didn't go quite the plan. Thought it seemed too good to be true. Turned out I wasn't meant to be fishing over there. We managed to get them fish feeding. On the pellets that I put in, water was clouded up. I thought this looks awesome. Ran back to the van, got a rod, fork had even cast out, bailiff hand on the shoulder. Not meant to be fishing here, son. So that's that. Joy to despair in 3 seconds flat, more or less. Feet are soaking wet, it started raining as well. Now I've got a mile walk back to the van, so my walking boots are ruined. But on the plus side, the bailiff did actually point out another spot, which he said is definitely worth checking out. There's a lot of carp there. So yeah, run back to the van and we'll go and check out this other spot. Well, I've arrived at the stretch that the bailiff recommended earlier on, and it's actually a place that has cropped up time and time again by people that have recommended it. My mate Lewis, he suggested this area, and Jake as well, who also put this challenge forward, he suggested this stretch, so it's come under good recommendation. Now the stretch itself is actually quite a barren piece of water. It's pretty straight and fairly featureless. You've got open fields along both banks. You've got pads down the margins, and there isn't really a lot to it. So looking at it, you can see why I've chosen this particular swim. It's the only area really where there's any cover. You've got these overhanging trees on the far margin. And like I mentioned before, the fish love structure. and you put this one bit of structure in amongst a mile of fairly featureless, barren bit of waterway, and hopefully the fish should be here. So actually there's quite a lot of roach and small fish topping. So again, you know, you think if they prefer this area, then hopefully the carp will too. Who knows? But I'm quietly confident, so I'm going to get a few rigs tied up and get started. Just been sat here on the bed chair looking out across the river, and I've just seen a carp head and shoulder about 6 foot from the far margin. I was staring right at the exact spot when it did it. I couldn't believe it. I grabbed Harry's knee when it did it. Oh mate, I'm so excited now. Right, let's get the rods in. Come on, I can't wait anymore, Harry. Hurry up. Did you see it?
Oh man.
Me and Harry are really excited now. We've just seen another fish roll on another spot. It wasn't the first fish I saw. The first fish I saw was a common of about 10, 12 pound. This one, I wouldn't like to put a size in it. Well, I mean, it rolled how far is it? 20 yard in front of me. It looked a mid 20 to me all day long. So it is looking promising. Let's hope I don't mess it up. Well, originally my plan was to give it a fair old bit of bait, but having seen two fish now showing the area, the fish are obviously here, so I don't want to start lazing in kilos and kilos of bait right on top of the heads. So all I'm going to do, I'm just going to put all three rods over the far side, which is where I've seen the fish anyway. I'm just going to go easy with the bait to start with. I'm just going to throw maybe half a dozen, 10 baits, just to sort of semi-spook the fish out the area, rather than just having a 4 ounce lead smashing in amongst them. So I'm going to throw in a few baits and just cast the rig over tight to the far margin. I mean, it's almost sort of like a canal really, because you've got a shelf on both sides and like a boat channel, if you like, where the boats move down. So I want to get it tight to that far margin. You can see the overhanging tree over there, and there's a few pads there as well. So I want to get it tight to there, so the rig's sat on top of that shelf. So let's do that. First of all though, throw out a few baits, if I can reach. Grab a back lead. There can be quite heavy boat traffic through this stretch at times. Let's grab a back lead. Just obviously to keep the line pinned down, so I don't get caught up on the back of a boat, on the propeller or anything. Swing this just off the main shelf, so it's down that channel. It's quite deep in that main channel as well, so at least I know the line will be out of harm's way. It's not for any line concealment or anything like that. I'm no river expert, but I don't think river carp are particularly line shy. They're not exactly pressured fish. Is purely just to keep it down out of harm's way, so I don't end up being attached to a boat. That just shows you the advantages of using strong tackle on rivers. I just cast over the far bank there, and as I was winding in, I caught up a branch, and it probably caught up about a rod length from the far margin. So this branch obviously coming out a fair way into the river. So I ended up pulling for a break, but if you look, I actually managed to snap the branch, and it isn't just a little branch either. That's a proper branch, that's a clean break. So yeah, 20 pound Exocet line, leg core leader, 20 pound Camatex soft duck link, size 2 SSBP, and the branch broke.
Yeah,
I win. Dejected, if I'm honest. Had nothing through the night. I kind of woke up about 2 o'clock in the morning and was just wide awake. Hadn't caught anything, and to be honest, I kind of expected to catch something around, I don't know, sometime during the night. And when I woke up at 2 in the morning and I hadn't caught one, I thought, are they still here? But it's now 4:30. I'm not seeing any signs that they are still here. I mean, obviously we saw them two fish yesterday, and I'm not seeing anything since I cast out, really. So whether that little bit of disturbance has sent them off upriver or downriver, I don't know. I'm just looking for something inspirational to happen. So I think the only thing to do is get the kettle on. That was pretty savage. Whew. I wasn't expecting that. These river carp bites are quite brutal. They've ran out barefoot. Harry managed to kick my other rod over. Thanks for that, Harry. It's just kind of lodged itself in the stream away down the middle though. The sun's bright. Oh, he's free. That was exciting for a few moments. Oh. Gutted. Absolutely gutted. Even the steaming kettle's annoying me now. Right, start again. I can't remember actually feeling this gutted for ages. I mean, I've had hook pulls and you think, ugh, never mind. But I feel wounded. Physically and mentally wounded. And I know they always feel big when you're losing. That one genuinely did feel like it. It just wasn't. Didn't feel skittish like a. I know it was pulling my arm off and everything, but it didn't feel skittish like a. You know, like a double. It just was just on a big, powerful sort of surge, and it was out of the snags. When I
when it came free, mate, it was out of the snags, just running up the middle channel. I just hope it isn't my only chance. One sort of, if I'm going to take a positive out of it, I always like to take a positive out of something bad, as you've probably noticed. But that bite kind of came not long after the first boat came through the swim. I think obviously it's just disturbed a bit of the bait, kicked it up a bit, and maybe it's just sparked off a bit of a, you know, a little bit of feeding response. So I'm kind of hoping now that all the boats have picked up, it might help things, because last night was pretty dead, which I wasn't expecting. But we'll see. Anyway, top up the swim with a bit more bait. I think I'll freshen the other two rods while I'm at it, and we'll try again. This is Jake, he's the man that set me this challenge. Look what he's done, he's only gone and popped down and brought me some fabs. What a legend. I've encountered the first bream or chub of the session. It's not a carp, put it that way. Well, it's something. I've actually just put on a slightly smaller up right now. I was fishing with double 18 mil. Fishing with an 18 mil topped off with a 10. And I did actually do it with kind of the expectation that I might hook a bream, just so I can see or gauge how much they're eating. On the double 18 mil, I'm not going to get pestered by bream. I don't know how many bream are in the swim, and I don't know how much bait's getting eaten. I mean, this rod's only been in the water a couple of hours. I've already had a bream, so at least now I know I need to keep topping up. Just allows me just to gauge the feeding a bit better. Well, the boat's just come through me swim, and he thought he was doing me a massive favour by going right over the far bank. But I think it's going to have disturbed all the bait. It's only about 5 foot deep over there. So I think all the wash is going to disturb that bait. Some of it will have rolled down the shelf. So I'm just going to top up with another 50-60 baits over each rod.
Warm up.
It's too warm to forget your shorts, I know that. Underpants are just shorts anyway. Feels good to get a bit of air going around them.
That doesn't even make sense. More. It's not even spelt more. What does M-double-O spell?
Moo.
Moo. No, it doesn't. Cows don't maw, do they? Anyway. Was that okay? My back channel was okay. Are you still filming? Crafty.
Did you talk about overhangs?
Yes, I talked about overhangs and back channels. Back. Following someone's remarks on YouTube on the last video, I'm going to do the rest of this session in my waders. someone pointed out that I'm always showing the full moon, which isn't my fault. I just happen to have an unusually high anus. What? So, in any case, full moons are carpy. So, what can I say? Carpy without knowing it.
Mm. Big Colin's like a full moon.
Exactly. Show him a full moon. Bosh.
What's your PV, Colin?
Well, 56.8, and that was actually on a full moon. The River Neen's full of commons. So actually, I'm going to take my waders off. Give them the full moon. Bosh, we can't fail.
Mr. Miyagi. Oh, I missed it.
Well, there isn't really a great deal to report since the last time you saw me. It's been kind of a frustrating day. This sort of fishing is just so alien to me. I like to think myself of being quite mobile. If I can't see fish, I'll move around, try and find them, but it's hard enough finding them as it is, and there isn't really many spots where you can actually visualise fish. You're just kind of almost going on a bit of a gut instinct in areas that you think they're going to be. I mean, I've had 3 bream today, so I know that there is fish visiting the spots and eating bait. And I have had a little bit of a tour. I went and checked out a spot up by a bridge upstream. Again, saw bream there. Harry, the cameraman, he saw a carp up there as well, but it's one carp a mile up the river when, you know, I know there are carp visiting this area. So I've stayed put for tonight. I did see a couple of fish roll a few moments ago. 2 fish in the space of a couple of minutes and then nothing. So I don't know, I'm kind of going into tonight hopeful, but not exactly brimful of confidence. But you know, I had that take last night. I know the carp are visiting here and feeding here, or at least one is or was. So, I guess we'll just have to see. Hopefully you'll see me in the middle of the night, all illuminated, playing my first river carp. Let's see, eh? Well, good morning. There isn't a lot to report, I'm afraid. Didn't even have any bream through the night, which I was expecting. I mean, I had 4 yesterday during the hottest part of the day, but yeah, even the bream left me alone last night. But what I'm going to do now, I'm going to show you the rigs I've been using so far this session. Now, this is what I started off with, and it is a fairly hefty setup. I mean, on the rivers there's all sorts of unseen obstacles and snags. There's quite a lot of weed running down that central channel as well, lots of heavy streamer weed, which that fish managed to free itself in. So yeah, you do need to beef the tackle up, and this is what I'm using. Hook link is about 7 inches, 8 inches of 20-pound Camatex Soft. And then coming down from there, we've got a big hook, a size 2, Armour Point SSBP hook, short shank beaked point hook. I've got one of the trans khaki line liner sleeves over there as well, just to help improve the hooking potential of the rig. Small piece of silicone down the shank to create a blowback effect. And the hook bait is double 18mm mainline hybrid boilies. Now, I started off using that because there is quite a lot of bream in the stretch, from what I've been told. So that was something that I felt that the bream wouldn't be able to deal with. But as the session went on, I changed things round a bit. I went over to a slightly more refined setup. The hook length's exactly the same. It's 20-pound Camatex Soft. This time it's going down to a size 4 XSC hook. Once again though, I've got the piece of silicone down the shank to create a blowback effect and a trans khaki line liner sleeve. Hook bait slightly smaller. It's an 18mm hybrid topped off with a 10mm fluoro cell pop-up. And it is a little bit more vulnerable to the attentions of bream, which is a good thing and a bad thing, depending on how you look at it. I like to look at it as a good thing. If I'm catching bream, it then just enables me to work out or get a good idea of how many bream are feeding in the swim. Yesterday I had 4 bream in the middle of the day, and every time I topped up with more bait. Whereas before, when I was fishing with the double 18mm, I had no bream action whatsoever. And I had no idea if there was bream eating bait in the swim or not. So this just enables me to just have a better idea of what exactly is happening under the water. Bream's just rolled in the swim, talking about it. Also, these rigs were fished on the Ready Tide lead core leaders. It's like 45-pound lead core leader, 2 foot long. Just really reinforces the last sort of few feet of the end tackle. Because there is quite a lot of snags and things out there, and they've got strong pads right under the rod tip as well, so should a hook a fish, it just gives it a little bit more reinforcement. But I mean, it's now gone past the time where I hooked that fish yesterday. I think it's going to be a hotter day today than it was yesterday. It's an absolute scorcher already. I'm not feeling it at all, to be honest. It's apart from that's the first bream I've seen roll for about 12 hours. I've not seen any carp since sort of yesterday evening. I'm not feeling that at all. I think the only chance I have got of saving this session now is to wind the rods in, go for a drive around a few more stretches. There's a few other stretches that have been sort of put to me. I'm gonna go and have a little look and see if we can get some sort of stalking opportunity. There's a few little sort of arms that come off the rivers that are full of pads. Few areas that are snaggy and overgrown, so I'm gonna go and have a walk, and hopefully there is time to rescue this challenge yet. Well, we've just been on a big old tour of the area. Check out a few of the stretches of the river that people have recommended. And sadly, all leads led to a dead end. Didn't see any signs of carp at all. Saw some lovely stretches of water though. And you know, if I had a few more days ahead of me, then you know, the probably would have been worth checking out. But for the next 2 or 3 hours, I really wanted to try and find a few fish and have a go at stalking them. But sadly, it wasn't meant to be. I mean, this session, this challenge was always going to be tough. In an ideal situation, I would like to have pre-baited spots or stretches for days or even a week or a couple of weeks leading up to the session. So to come down and try and catch a carp off the cuff in 48 hours was always going to be a very tall ask. But we nearly did it, that's the thing. We came so close. That first morning, hooked that fish, which I sadly lost in the weed, came so close. And I am still 48 hours on, absolutely gutted about that. I think you can tell in my voice, I am really distraught over it. I'll have to come back sometime and settle the scores, I'm sure. But another positive you can take from it is people are always saying that there's all the day-ticket lakes are busy, you can't get swims, there's fighting for swims. But we've walked 5 or 6 miles of river while I've been down here. We've seen one other angler, and he was course fishing. We haven't seen any other carp anglers in 5 or 6 miles of river. And there's fish over 30 pounds in the river. The ticket we got was 20 pounds for a year as well. So when you put that in perspective, it's unbelievable value. But I think the only thing left for me to do now, it's nearly 25 degrees, it's baking hot. I've walked for miles and miles. There's a pub behind me, so I'm gonna get a nice cold beer, and I'll see you next time.